In this benchmark, we'll compare performance of Java and Golang applications running in Kubernetes. We'll measure a bunch of different things, including CPU usage and memory usage for each application. In some tests, we also measure how long it takes for each application to read a file from the local file system, upload it to S3 bucket, and write metadata about that file to a relational database like Postgres. Now, the best way to get accurate measurement of latency is to use external clients to send requests through all the proxies and load balancers on the way to the application. This approach gives you the same latency that any other end user of your application would experience. In the previous benchmark, I used older Spring Boot framework that runs on JVM. In this video, I'll be using Quarkus Java framework, which is optimized for Kubernetes deployments. If you visit their website, you'll see that Quarkus is specifically built for containers, and they claim it is Kubernetes native. According to them, memory usage is very low, and application start time is much faster compared to traditional JVM-based Java applications. The reason for this improvement is that Quarkus uses GraalVM JDK to compile the code into native platform executables. These executables are ideal for containers and cloud deployments. And of course, we'll be testing all of this. On the other hand, we'll be using Golang Fiber framework, which is one of the highest performance frameworks available for the language. I initially thought of using the standard library, but since we're using a framework for Java, it makes sense to use one for Golang as well. We often use percentiles instead of average duration to measure request latency because percentiles provide a more accurate representation. For example, we use P50, P90, and P99 percentiles. If the P90 percentile is 100 milliseconds, it means 90% of requests are completed in under 100 milliseconds. For P99, it means 99% of the requests completed within that time. Now, why not to use average duration? Let's say you have 100 requests and 95 of them take 100 milliseconds, while 5 take 2 seconds. Maybe a downstream application was restarting, or a cache like Redis was unavailable for a short period, which led to those 5 requests being forced to time out. In this case, the average latency might be around 190 milliseconds. This suggests that all users would experience slow performance, but that's not actually what's happening. Now, let's say we use P90 percentile instead of average latency. In this example, P90 percentile might be around 100 milliseconds. This indicates that 90% of all requests are handled quickly, with only a small fraction being slow. By focusing on percentiles, especially higher ones like P95 and P99, you can better understand and optimize worst-case performance scenarios that may impact user experience. For the first test, we'll focus on the framework itself. There will be a standard slash health endpoint, which Kubernetes will use to probe the application's health. Additionally, we'll have another endpoint slash API slash devices, which will return hard-coded connected devices in JSON format. This object will include device ID, MAC address, and firmware version. In Golang, we'll create a struct and serialize it to JSON when the client sends a request to that endpoint. In Java, we'll create a class and use a Java library to convert it to a JSON and return it to the client. We'll also have a client that sends requests to that endpoint, measures each one, and exposes results as Prometheus metrics. We'll use percentiles to measure latency for each request. Additionally, we'll configure CIAdvisor to scrape each pod and provide metrics for CPU and memory usage. All these metrics will be scraped by Prometheus, and we'll use Grafana to create a few dashboards. For the second test, we'll simulate a real-world use case. when the client sends a request to the application on the /API/images endpoint, application will read a file from the local file system and upload it to S3 compatible object store. In our case, we'll use Minio. After that, application will take a timestamp and write it along with other metadata about the image to the relational database. We'll use Postgres for this. We'll also measure client latency and the time taken for each function call, including how long it takes to upload the image and how long it takes to write to the database. Metrics will be exposed for Prometheus to scrape, and we'll create additional dashboards. So we'll expose Prometheus metrics from both the client to measure end user performance and the applications to measure specific internal function calls. The source code is available in my public GitHub repository. Many companies now use public clouds like AWS, Azure, and GCP to quickly scale up when demand is high and scale down when demand decreases. This helps reduce infrastructure cost by paying for the compute only when you need it. To make the most of this, you need to optimize your applications for cloud environments. Your applications should be small and have a fast boot time to allow for quick scaling. When Kubernetes scales your application, it needs to pull the new images of your application on each node. In many cases, we also scale Kubernetes node group by adding more nodes. This means you can't rely on your images being cached on every Kubernetes node. The size of the application image is very important for how quickly Kubernetes can scale your application. The larger the image size, the longer it takes to download and scale up, among other factors. First, let's compare the image sizes of Go and Java. These applications use official SDKs for AWS, drivers for Postgres, and Prometheus libraries to measure function calls. For Go, we will use a common multi-stage build pattern. We'll use a Go image to compile the application into a binary, and then use distroless Debian image to run it. This image, provided and used internally by Google, is very small but includes essential components that many applications require, such as public certificates for making API calls to external services. Additionally, if your Go application uses dynamic linking, you might prefer using distroless over Scratch images and copying all the required libraries. Now, when we build it locally, the image will be around 47 megabytes. However, what really matters is the compressed size of the image. One way to find the compressed size is to go to your Docker Hub account. For example, the Go image is around 18 megabytes. It's very small. Another way is to SSH into one of the Kubernetes nodes and use Containerd CLI to list all images on that particular node. In this case, the Go image is about 19 megabytes. Now, let's take a look at Java. When you generate a project with the CLI, you have a few options for building Docker images. You can use traditional JVM-based images, but to minimize the size, we'll use native micro Docker file to build the image. To build it, you first need to compile Java code into a native executable, and then you take that file and copy it to the final image. After compiling and building the image, the final size is 127 megabytes, which is almost 3 times larger than the Go image. Let me check the compressed size of that image on one of the Kubernetes nodes. The compressed size is around 41 megabytes, which is still twice as large as Go compressed image size of 19 megabytes. However, it's still a fraction of the traditional JVM-based images, which can be up to 1 GB or more. So with Quarkus, you get really small images, but they're still larger than Go images. Before we run the tests, let's measure how long it takes for the pod to start and become ready. We can use pod conditions to track this. We'll use pod scheduled status as a starting point and ready status as endpoint. The pod becomes ready after it passes the health checks. For this test, we'll use interval of 1 second. Let's make sure we're not using cached images by deleting Golang image from one node and Java image from another node. This way, we can measure not only how long it takes for the application to start, but also how long it takes to pull that image to the node before starting application. Now, let's go ahead and deploy both applications to Kubernetes. Even at this point, you can see that it took slightly longer for the Java pod to become ready. Next, let's check conditions for the Golang pod. The pod was scheduled at 32:56 and became ready at 33:06. So it took around 10 seconds. Now let's see how long it took for the Java app. It became ready at 33:07, just 1 second later. I ran this test a few times and results are more or less consistent. It takes slightly longer to start JavaPod because the image is larger, so it takes longer to download. However, the difference is very small. Alright, let's go ahead and run the first test. Here we'll test only the frameworks themselves. First, I'll deploy both Go and Java applications to Kubernetes and run them for about 5 minutes. You can see that in idle state, Java uses more CPU and significantly more memory than the Go application, but this doesn't last for a long, as you'll see shortly. I have a client that slowly increases the number of requests to each application, as shown in this graph, and it is also measures the latency of each request. In this case, we'll measure P99 percentile latency for the client. You can see that the overall latency for the Go application is lower than the Java application. The CPU usage for Java also remains higher than Go, but what really surprised me is that Java's memory usage drops when we start the test and stays as low as Go for the remainder of the test. Let me run it for a few more seconds. Alright, let me open each graph for the entire duration of the test. Here is the memory usage graph. Next, we have the CPU usage graph. This usage is calculated based on the pod's CPU limit and actual usage, with CPU and memory metrics provided by CAdvisor. Here we have the client latency for each application. These metrics exposed by the clients themselves. Finally, we have requests per second graph. By the end, there is a jump from 300 RPS to 400, which is intentionally configured on the client to measure how well the application can handle increase in the load. That's all for the first test. Now, the second test focused on a common use case where we interact with the S3 bucket and also write or read from the database. So let me redeploy both Go and Java applications and run it for about 20 minutes. So far, we have the same results. Java's CPU and memory usage are higher in idle state, with memory usage staying around 20% until we start the test. Let me go ahead and start. As you can see, the Java application requires more CPU to read the file uploaded to S3 and write to the database. On the other hand, memory usage is almost identical to that of Go, which is very nice to see. Next, we have the latency for the S3 operations. Java is slightly slower in terms of reading the file and uploading it to S3. You can take a look at the source code and compare it with the Go implementation. However, when it comes to database operations, Java is actually faster than Go. This is mostly due to the implementation of the libraries. Finally, we have the overall latency measured from the client, which gives you a precise idea of how any end-user client would perform. In this test, Java is also slightly slower than Go. If you have any use cases or test scenarios in mind where Java might perform better than Go, please let me know and I'll create additional benchmarks to show when you should choose Java over Go. Alright, let me open CPU usage graph. Next, we have the memory usage graph. Here is the client latency graph. This is the requests per second graph. Here is the S3 latency graph. And finally, we have database latency graph. I have a playlist with a bunch of different benchmarks, if you're interested. Let me know what should I test next, maybe different languages or open source projects. Thank you for watching and I'll see you in the next video.